What the fuck is this piece of shit?
I'm sure we all have at least one friend we can consider a living database of memes, ready for whatever life or you may throw at them. Quite the fascinating beings they are, and certainly worth studying, and if lucky, maybe even replicate to a certain degree. As some would say, imitation is the sincerest form of flattery, and so I've decided to honor my friends, and yours as well, that fall within this category, by doing what any sane person would attempt, create sentient life. Well, sentient life may be the tiniest bit of an overstatement, but this video will still be showing you the trials and tribulations I've been through while developing an empathetic AI-powered chatbot that responds with appropriate memes to your each and every message. To this project there are three main components, although some are more main than the others. The mainest main component is the program that will be training the model using NLP, or natural language processing, techniques on certain sets of curated data. Next, using this model, a simple API will be developed which, based on a user's message, will predict its underlying emotion and then generate a response containing a meme or a GIF based on that emotion. Finally, a simple web app that will act as the user interface for communicating with the API will be needed so that the user will feel like they're talking to an actual person. Great, now let's get started with the most difficult part, cause I ain't no coward. There are several stages to NLP, the first being finding a viable dataset to use so that your model isn't just training on nonsense or incomplete data. Fortunately, emotion detection is a subject of interest to many, so I was able to find a couple datasets on Kaggle, one with extracts from various documents and another with tweets, both having associated emotions. Worth mentioning is the fact that the number of emotions was limited to happy, sad, anger, fear, disgust, and surprise for better accuracy of the end results, as when totaling my datasets there were around 50,000 entries, which may sound like a lot, but oh boy is it not. And I'm not even comparing sizes with the big boys like ChatGPT, Bing Copilot, or Google's Bard. By the way, did you know that the chatbot I'm building is supposed to be able to understand phrases like, if you're enjoying the video, consider liking and subscribing, and other similar stuff. Next up, I had to aggregate these datasets and separate them into training and testing. Normally you'd also want a validation set, but oh well, my eyes and brain will suffice. So, by parsing the CSV files, keeping only the appropriate columns, removing invalid entries, shuffling the valid ones, then splitting the aggregated data into an 8 to 20 ratio of training to testing, followed by reducing the available classified emotions to those mentioned earlier, the first part of the first part of the process was done. Now, I had to pre-process these entries so that the models would have consistent and qualitative data to train on. This pre-processing consisted of multiple operations applied to each individual entry, and so I didn't spend half a day just pre-processing them, I made use of DAS, a Python package that allowed me to parallelize the process. Okay, so for each entry, aka piece of text, I started by setting it to lowercase, followed by removing speech unrelated terms like URLs, tags, mentions, non-ASCII characters, anything we wouldn't be using in casual conversation, then removed all punctuation and other special characters. Next, I fixed contractions, stuff like transforming didn't into did not, and so on. Then normalized white spaces and tokenized the text string so that now I would be working with independent words. Following this, I removed stop words, meaning words so widely used that they rarely hold any value, such as the, is, a, and then transformed abbreviations to their equivalent, corrected spellings, and finally performed what is called stemming on all of the words, where stemming is the process of removing all parts of a word that are unnecessary to lexical analysis, except for its core, its stem. So, for example, going from the word planning to its core plan. Awesome! This means we're almost done with all this modeling gig, right? Here comes the fun part, choosing a classifier and fine-tuning its hyperparameters. Because for me, at least with the knowledge I have now, choosing the right components of the bat isn't really ingrained into my thought process. I took the hard-working route of testing multiple classifiers, choosing those that performed best and then adding them to a pipeline, hoping that by stacking them I would get even better results. There were many classifiers to choose from, like logistic regression, naive Bayes, SVM or support vector machines, decision tree, KNN or random forest. each with their own pros and cons, some more suited to some tasks than others and vice versa. In the end, the best performing turned out to be logistic regression, studying the relationship between dependent, independent, and outcome variables, and SVM, a set of learning algorithms that analyze data for classification and regression analysis, aka forecasting. Both performing well in classification problems, the one I'm dealing with being the perfect example of that, given the limited number of emotions studied. I then took these two, put them in a pipeline along with a vectorizer, in this case TF-IDF vectorizer, which converts the raw text into matrices of TF-IDF features before passing it to the classifiers. But what is TF-IDF, you may ask? Well, it stands for Term Frequency Inverse Document Frequency, and measures how important words are in a document, so that words occurring with higher frequency in a text will be more important when classifying that text. So like if my text contains the word sad 5 times and happy once, the classifier will attribute the term sad a lot more weight in determining if the emotion is sadness, as opposed to happiness, avoiding cases in which the model might learn that seeing the word happy would automatically confirm it being happiness. And now you may think, well, that's it, right? Finally, I had to fine-tune the hyperparameters for each individual classifier. These are extremely important, being pretty much make-or-break elements in getting valuable models. Each of these parameters manages certain parts or flows in the classifier. For example, the penalty is applied when the model makes a prediction mistake during training, and plays a vital role in preventing under- or overfitting of the model. And because it's not an exact science, I left it to fate, choosing a strategy that would let me specify ranges for these hyperparameters, then choosing randomly from them when running the classifiers. And I'm not joking, this is a valid approach called randomized search with high risk and matching high rewards. But now I could let it do its thing, and boy, it took its time. I gave up on waiting for it to finish and peacefully went to sleep, hoping to see some nice results in the morning. And what do you know, a decent enough score meant I could finally move on to doing the next parts of the project. Phew, that was a lot to take in. But at least now we can relax with some more down-to-earth things. What followed this entire adventure was creating the API that would transform a message into a reactionary image, or in this case a GIF, as I had discovered Giphy. You know, that thing that is present in whichever chatting or social media app you may think of? Actually quite a handy tool. I could query for simple words like happy or sad, and it would have numerous GIFs perfectly matching that emotion. And what's best, it turned out it had a free-to-use API, as well as an endpoint specifically for returning a random GIF for a certain query. Exactly what I needed to add that touch of spontaneity to the bot's choice of reaction. Using this, coupled with the just created prediction model, I created our API and its single endpoint using Fast API, as anything more complicated would have literally been useless. Finally, the frontend was done using SvelteKit, consisting of a single page recreating the look of a basic chatting app. And by tying the web app to the API, I could finally call this project done. Now I can send messages to my beloved empathetic friend, who can definitely hold his own in the big leagues, and get appropriate, compassionate responses to my varied emotional states. Also, I'm just pretending to be volatile for testing purposes, okay?